Please be seated. We are living in extraordinary times. Because of world events, only a very few of us can physically gather here today. But I want to extend a warm welcome to family and friends from all over the world who are joining us today via webcast and who we know would dearly love to be with us as we say farewell to Dad. Particularly in our thoughts today is our mum, who is currently in Gloucester Royal Hospital recovering from a hip operation following a fall that she had last Thursday. We hope that once this current madness is over, that we will hold another service to celebrate the life of Dad. And we do hope that those who can't be with us today will join us for that service in the future. But as we gather here today, we do so not just to grieve and to mourn, but also to celebrate and give thanks for the life of our dad, John Albert Green. Death has come to Dad, as it will eventually come to every one of us. And as we gather, we do so to thank God for him, to consider, to remember, and to honour his life and the memories that we share. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." Let's pray. Father God, your love is stronger than death. By you, we are all being brought to life. Help us, as we hear the promises of your word, to receive the comfort that they offer. You are the giver of hope at this time of grief. Fill us with your peace, that our fears may be dispelled, our loneliness eased, and our hope reawakened. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Anthony.
This reading is taken from 1 Corinthians, verse 4 to verse 6. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast. It is not proud, it is not rude. It is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes. Love never fails.
Dad was born in Bridgend on the 23rd of September 1929. He was the second child of five brothers and one sister to Geraldus and Irene Green. Dad would not describe his childhood as being a particularly happy one. He often talked about the challenges and the difficulties he faced as he grew up. The constant pangs of hunger, the having to go without, the poor relationship that he felt he had with his own father. His dream when he grew up was to be an engineer with the Merchant Navy, but that dream was effectively ended when he was just 14 years old. He was in bed one night when his father came into his room and said, "John, I've got a job for you in the pit. You start tomorrow. You need to be up at 4 a.m. And that is where Dad spent the next 25 years of his life, moving between South Wales and the Forest of Dean until he left the pits in 1968, just shortly after we moved to Lydney. He did numerous jobs after that, but he never ever really achieved his childhood ambition. Mum and Dad met, and later they married, but even that wasn't straightforward. Because of objections raised by members of his family, they had to resort to getting married in a registry office in Neath, with just a few select people present. And then later they had their marriage blessed at the chapel that they both attended in Glenheath. I wanted to say all that because It's important to know Dad's history in order to understand the man that he became. Dad was haunted by the demons of his childhood for the rest of his life. And those demons very much shaped the man he became. Those of us who grew up with him, and those of us who were close to him in these final few months, will know what I mean by that. But understanding his background was key to understanding him. When I was writing this, and I was thinking about Dad, about the kind of person he was, a number of words came to mind, most of which I couldn't possibly repeat in public. But when I trained as a Baptist minister, we were told that any good sermon had 3 points, and each one started with the same letter. Well, today, to describe Dad, I've got 6 words, and each one begins with the letter H. The first word is handy. Dad was someone who could turn his hand to anything, from decorating to plumbing, electrics, car mechanics, gardening. There was little that he couldn't do. And if he couldn't do it, it wouldn't take him long to find out how to do it. I've known him knock 2 rooms into one. I've known him put in stairs in a house. I've known him install central heating, fix broken TVs, and even rebuild a steam engine. If ever he came to stay, he would spend most of his time going around the house doing the jobs that we hadn't or couldn't do. The second word is helpful. There is no one that Dad wouldn't help if it was within his ability to do so. I remember one night when we lived in Gloucester, I was only about 10. It was quite late in the evening and there was a knock on the door. Dad answered, and it was a young guy who was being chased by a gang. There was a group of them at one end of the street, a group of them at the other end of the street, and this poor guy was stuck terrified in the middle. So Dad put him in the car and drove him to safety. I won't mention the time he got me into a fight in a pub in Exeter when he went to help defend the landlord from an aggressive drunk. But while I am talking about Dad's helpful nature, I want to say something that I think is quite important. Dad wasn't someone who could express his emotions very well. It wasn't really in his nature to hug us as kids or to tell us that he loved us. But if we ever needed him, if we were ever in trouble, he would be the first to come calling. When we were living in Germany and our baby son Adam died, Mum and Dad dropped everything, jumped on a plane, and was there to support us through one of the darkest periods of our lives. When Anthony was born, I know that Dad was a tremendous support to Janet and Mike, taking food to them during their long stays in hospital, helping them out financially, and looking after Anthony over the years so that they could find some respite. Dad was someone who found it difficult to verbally express his love for us. But he did express it in the countless ways that he was there for each of us, and how he supported each one of us in times of crisis. And we've all had our fair share of those over the years. The third word is hygienic. And what I mean by that is that Dad was a bit of a clean freak. No doubt it was a throwback to his mining days when he would be covered from head to foot in coal dust. But this clean phobia that he had expressed itself in many different ways. His turnout was always immaculate. I don't think a day ever went by when he didn't shave or comb his hair, that he didn't wear a collar and tie. In the house, everything was polished, hoovered, the kitchen was spotless. In the latter years, when they employed cleaners to come and clean for them, he gave them very specific instructions on how everything had to be done. And he fired a few of them in the process. Even his car was immaculate. And I just don't mean the outside and the inside, but the engine as well. Not a speck of dirt or oil to be seen anywhere. Fourth word is humour. Dad did have a sense of humour. It was a little bit strange, a little bit warped at times, and not everybody got it. And sometimes he just thought he was being funny when really he wasn't at all. But I think it is testament to him that everybody, and I mean everybody, who has contacted me since he has passed to express their sympathies, the one thing they have all mentioned was his sense of humour. Fifth word is honest. Dad was an honest man. Integrity was everything to him. I remember going shopping with him once to Matalan in Edinburgh. There was me, Michelle, Mum and Dad. And between the four of us, we bought quite a lot of clothes. And we decided that we would just put it into a pile, pay for it in a wanna, and then sort out who owed what when we got home. Well, when we got home and we went through the receipt, we discovered that we hadn't actually paid for two coats. Now, most people would say, yeah, we got away with that. But not Dad. The following day, he made me go back to the shop, where much to the surprise of the cashier, we explained what had happened and paid for the two coats. But this final word to me stands out more than any other. Holy. Dad was a holy man. That's not to say he was perfect. We all know that he wasn't. But he was a man of faith who tried his best to live a life that was pleasing to God. He was a founding and stalwart member of the Mount of Olives Church in Coford. He was baptized in the Holy Spirit one Sunday morning when he was a mile underground doing a shift down the pits. And over the years, he was a great supporter to Pastor Chambers, Williamson, Smith, and Pidgeley. He was also a mighty prayer warrior. And I know that every morning after Mum and Dad had had their breakfast, Mum would read the scriptures and the daily devotions, and then Dad would faithfully pray for and commit each one of us and our families to God's care and protection. Handy, helpful, hygienic, humorous, honest, holy. And yeah, a man who loved his fish and chips. These are words that describe Dad to a T. In 1991, while working in Hastings, ill health forced both him and Mum to take early retirement. And Dad never really recovered from that. In his retirement years, he devoted quite a lot of his time to his two remaining passions, gardening and fishing. He was diagnosed with bowel cancer just 12 months ago. And these past few months have been difficult, to say the least. He did manage to see his 90th birthday in September last year, and just long enough for he and Mum to celebrate their 70th wedding anniversary, just 2 weeks before he died. Life is going to seem strange without him. We will miss his wisdom, his counsel, his advice, and maybe even his humour. And we will do our very best to look after and take care of Mum, who he is now left behind. But Dad is now finally at peace. We can take comfort from the fact that he is where he has yearned to be for so long, away from the body and at home with the Lord, resting in the arms of his Saviour. And I have no doubt that he has finally heard those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant."
Lord, I come to you. Let
One of Dad's favourite readings, one of Dad's favourite chapters from the Bible was Romans chapter 8. And I just want to read the final few verses from that chapter. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution or famine, or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The death of someone we love is a time that is filled with pain and with grief. And to speak into that grief can be very difficult. Those who feel deeply will also grieve deeply. And there is no faith, no religion, no life philosophy that will ever change that. There is nothing that tugs at our heartstrings quite in the same way that a funeral does. In the twinkling of an eye, a loved one has passed from life to afterlife, from temporal to eternal, leaving friends, family, and neighbours behind. And we can't pretend that everything is okay, because it's not okay. A husband, a father, a brother, a granddad, an uncle, and a friend has been taken from us. And it hurts. And we know that it's going to hurt for a long time. We were created to live in relationship with one another. And when that relationship is lost, we feel pain. These times will normally bring out the best and the worst in us. On the one hand, we reminisce about the good times that we enjoyed, the experiences we had together, the laughter that we shared. We think of the legacy that Dad leaves behind for future generations. And we hope, beyond hope, that we too one day will have something that we can leave behind to those that follow us. And then there's the other side of our emotion. The pain, the grief, the anger. And maybe today we are all searching for answers. Why do bad things happen? Why do some people suffer and others do not? What is the purpose of life? And the questions just keep on racing through our heads. The one thing that will comfort us is our memories. Everyone here today and everybody watching via the webcast will come with their own memories of the moments they shared with Dad. Memories which capture those special times, special moments that are now frozen in time forever. And it's important for us to hold on to those memories. Hold on to them as though they were precious jewels. Words of comfort that speak into our grief and our mourning are hard to find. But our memories of the good times will embrace us. The memories of the good times will comfort us. They will begin to soothe the pain and the loss that we feel. And in the days that lie ahead, days that will remain difficult and painful as we try to adjust with Dad no longer being here, it is important that we continue to look to each other for mutual support. That we uphold each other in love. That we embrace each other in our grief. That we weep with each other as we share our pain. And laugh with each other as we continue to remember the good times. There's also one more thing that will bring us comfort. We are all walking this journey that we call life, but none of us know where, when, or how our journey is going to end. But we can all share one thing that Dad had in abundance, and that is the hope of glory. That this is not the end, that there is something more, there is something better, there is something greater. And like Dad, I too am convinced that in this life and the next, we can be more than conquerors through him that loved us. And I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Merciful God, you have made us all and given your Son for our redemption. We now commend our dad, John, to your perfect mercy and wisdom. For in you alone we put our trust. Would you please stand? We have entrusted Dad to God's gracious keeping, and we now commit his body to be cremated, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord Jesus, our Redeemer, you willingly gave yourself up to death so that all might be saved and pass from death to life. By dying, you unlocked the gates of life for all those who believe in you. And so we commend our dad into your arms of mercy, believing that with sins forgiven, he will share a place of happiness, light and peace in the kingdom of your glory forever. And may the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep guard over our hearts and our thoughts in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen.